Hello students, today we are going to see the serial communication in detail. I will mainly concentrate on the all basic concepts of serial communication. So let's start. The communication, as the word communication says that we communicate means we transfer the information from one person to another person. As the same fashion we exchange the information between two person, we also exchange the information between two satellites, between two antennas. Also, as there is a digital circuitry, we involve the microcontroller, we involve the peripheral devices. So we expect that these must communicate independently. In order to have communication between them, some protocols are predefined by IEEE standards. If we classify the communication, it is broadly classified into two main parts. So data transmission is of two types, as I said, serial and parallel. Further, the serial communication is again of two types. One is called as a synchronous and second is called as asynchronous. You can have the same analogy that we know synchronous counters and asynchronous counter. As in synchronous counter, we use a clock, and on the basis of age of the clock, all the flip-flops are going to do their task. They are going to change their state. In same fashion, in serial communication, there will be a clock. On the age of each clock, all devices are going to take the action. Asynchronous communication, in same fashion, the clock is absent over there. But by some means of standards, we have the communication between them. First, we'll see what is a parallel communication. So when we say that there are two devices and they have the parallel communication, let's assume that they want to exchange the 1 byte information. So as it is shown in this figure, on the right hand side, there is a transmitter. On the left hand side, there is a receiver. So transmitter is having D0 to D7 lines, and also the receiver is having D0 to D7 line. So here it gives an idea that the number of bits you want to transfer, that many number of lines you must have. For each bit, there will be one line. Like here, as there are 8 bits to be transferred, we have the 8 data lines. So all 8 lines are connected from the transmitter to the receiver. And in one clock, you can send all these 8 bits from one place to another place. That is a parallel communication. Whereas in serial communication, instead of having number of lines equal to number of bits, we have only one line between the transmitter and the receiver. And on this line, one by one, we are supposed to send the each bit. Initially, you may send the least significant bit or you may send the most significant bit. The parallel communication, as I said, it is the all bits are going to move from the source to the destination. The parallel communication is going to have the faster execution because of its multiple lines, and each line is going to transfer the individual bit. The parallel transfers, if I consider in terms of the wires, as there are multiple number of wires are required as equal to the number of bits to be transferred. So by that sense, you can say that it's a quite most expensive as compared to the hardware part. And if you use so many wires, suppose for 8-bit, it seems to be okay using 8 lines, but for 64-bit, there will be 64 lines. And like this, if you want to have the parallel communication between the microcontroller and all its peripheral, then it will be a so complex cablings will be there. So if you want to show the parallel communication, mainly it is shown like this. These lines are called as a bus, or it is called as a group of lines. Some people use this kind of representation. Whereas you can use a single line and it can have one cross, and there you can specify how many lines are there, like this n is equal to 8. It means that it is a bus, and that bus is internally having total 8 lines for the transmission. Otherwise, you can use this kind of symbol, that is a big arrow, and within that arrow you can specify the width of that arrow. So here it is again specifying that n is equal to 8 means it is able to transfer 8 bits at a time from source to the destination. As we have seen the parallel communication, we have seen advantages of parallel communication. Now we can see the disadvantages of parallel communication. As I said that there will be more number of wires. If you want to have the parallel transfer, that is going to increase the cost of your design. So hardware point of view, as the more number of wires are needed, it is a quite expensive circuit. Similarly, as you want to have the high transfer rate, because on all parallel lines, the data transfer may be in the rate of gigabits per second. There is one condition, and that condition is called as a impedance matching. Impedance matching, let me give an example. Impedance matching, as you are having the radio, and you want to listen to a particular station, there you have the concept of impedance matching. Internally in your radio, you are having one circuit that is having some inductance and capacitance. So when the frequency, it is called as a resonance frequency, when that impedance gets matched with the impedance of the transmitting station, then that time you have the high resonance, means the maximum power is transferred. Similarly, when you want to transfer a data from transmitter to the receiver, all these parallel lines, as they are carrying a data, they act like a capacitors, and also the inductive nature they have in between. Because of this inductive and capacitive nature, they get an impedance developed. So this impedance at the transmitter side and receiver side must be perfectly matched. Otherwise, you may have the distortions in your signal transfer. As I said, these long lines are going to have the capacitive and inductive nature in between. Because of this, what you experience is called as a crosstalk. Crosstalk in the sense, data from one line may corrupt the data in the another line. Like in the telephone lines, while you are receiving a call, you may listen the another communication. And that is an example of the crosstalk. In same fashion, if you want to transfer a data on a particular line, suppose you are interested in transmitting logic 1, but after some time you realize that when you receive a data on that line, you got a 0. So because of the crosstalk, your data may get changed, and it is called as a distortion or a noise as well. Now here, as I said, that the signal may appear as a noise, and what is we are going to get is nothing but a degrading in the performance. So these all are the disadvantages of parallel communication. And yes, one more very important disadvantage of your parallel communication is that for the parallel data transfer, you require that many number of IC pins. As that many number of IC pins is required, the size of IC is going to increase. The material used to design IC will be increased. As a result, the cost of IC will go higher. So all these are the disadvantages of parallel communication. Now you will ask what to do. The simple answer is that as we have tried the parallel communication, why not to try the serial communication? Let's see what is a serial communication. In serial communication, as we have already seen the comparison between parallel and serial communication, there will be a single line only between the transmitter and the receiver. And on that single line, one bit will be transferred at a time. Serial data communication requires a single path, okay, a single cable, or you can say that compared to the parallel transfer, a less circuitry is needed. Now, since only a single path is required, we can have this wireless communication as well. As in case of the wireless, there is a particular dedicated band is used between the transmitter and receiver, and over that wireless channel, you transfer the data. So we also think about the wireless option. Further, as in serial communication, the hardware cost is less. Either it is a wired or wireless, single channel is there, single path is there. So compared to the parallel communication, it has the less cost. And as today, the serial communication, if you talk about the speed is not a limiting factor, because higher standard interfaces are available nowadays. So as an advantage, though I say that a single path is needed, but though we say it is a single path, but there is additionally one path is also needed, and that represents the ground. So whenever we want to say a single path, actually it is a two paths, and second path is used for the ground, and whatever the path which is not connected to ground, that will carry your main data from one place to other place. So as data path is very simple, requires only two wires, it is quite less expensive. In serial data path, the bits are to be transferred in a sequence one by one. As first bit is transferred, then we send the second bit, then third. So depending upon a time change, you are going to send each bit from one place to other place. You may transfer the least significant bit first, or you may transfer the most significant bit first. When you transfer least significant bit first, then that is called as a little Indian architecture. When you transfer most significant bit first, then that is called as a big Indian architecture. At the last of this PPT, I have covered the difference between little Indian and big Indian architecture. So this is one simple example is given. So if this is a 8-bit word and you want to transfer 96, if I convert 9, that will become 1001, and 6 will become 0110. That is hexadecimal character conversion in binary. So 1 will be represented by high, 0 will be represented by low. And like this, the representation of your data will be there. This is a 8-bit word. And if you want to transfer 8-bit word, you can transfer the least significant bit first, or you can transfer the most significant bit first. As we have seen the advantages of serial communication, no doubt the serial communication is also having some limitations. Let's see it in brief. As the primary downside of serial communication is that we have to wait till all bits are transferred from one end to another end. If there is a longer frame to be transferred, suppose instead of 8-bit you want to transfer 64-bit of information, then you may be needed for the time duration, which is 64 times the time duration of single bit. So that is, it takes a longer time to transmit the word from one place to other place. If you compare with the parallel transfer, whereas the parallel transfer may take the 50 nanoseconds to transfer over a short bus, at the same time, if you go with the serial communication, it may take these several hundreds of the nanoseconds to transfer data from one place to another place serially. Though we found this as a disadvantage, but nowadays there are so many interfaces are available, and those interfaces are going to work at the rate of gigabits per second. So literally people found that using serial communication is not a bad choice. If we are not required that much high speed of data, then definitely going for serial communication is a less costlier option available for us. Now let's see how the serial data rate is defined. Serial data rate, denoted by the symbol R, is defined as the number of bits transferred per second. So that's why the unit is a bits per second. It is a reciprocal of the bit time. So bit time is a time duration of representation of logic 1 or logic 0. It is nothing but the time taken by 0 or time taken by 1. So if you take inverse of that, you get a reciprocal of bit time. So here the data rate is given by 1 upon TB. Alternatively, if you have the data rate, you also can calculate the bit time by using the formula, that is TB is equal to 1 by R, that is rearranging the first equation. If we have the bit time of 5 nanosecond, suppose a logic 0 or logic 1 is going to take 5 nanosecond duration, then what will be the data rate? If you calculate, the data rate will be equal to, it is given by R is equal to 1 upon TB. So TB here is 5 nanosecond. If you calculate, the answer is 200 megabits per second. So within 1 second, you can transfer 200 into 10 to the power 6 bits from one end to the another end on a single line. If you are having a data rate of say 9600 bits per second, then what will be the bit time? And if you can calculate that TB is equal to 1 upon R, you can calculate that it will take 104.167 microseconds. So if the data rate is given, you can calculate how much time will be taken by 0 or 1 to get transmitted over line. And the period here comes out to be in microseconds, that is almost equal to 104 microseconds approximately. As we have seen the data rate, let's see the relation between data rate and bandwidth. Let me give an example. If you have a car and if you want to drive a car at a maximum speed, and if the road is very narrow, then definitely there will be a limitation on your speed. You will not be able to drive the car at a maximum speed. On the other side, if we give a road which is around 100 meter wide, and if now ask you to drive the car at a maximum speed, then definitely you will say that it is quite easier. So here what I want to say is that the width of the road is very important. In same fashion, what is the width of your channel? That is called as a bandwidth. How much is the bandwidth it supports? That is going to have the effect on the data rate. So it's a very important point. People use different methods to define the bandwidth or the relation between bandwidth and the data rate. So in most cases, any channel that looks like a low pass filter. Low pass filter is something that is from 0 to say up to cutoff frequency, we want to transfer the data. So low pass filter is going to transfer all the signals till it cutoff frequency, and all the frequency which are above the cutoff frequency will not be passed. So that cutoff frequency is called as the upper cutoff frequency. So that upper cutoff frequency decides the maximum speed of the data. The simple way is that in order to get that cutoff frequency, people generally go from its maximum amplitude 3 dB below, so it is called as a minus 3 dB bandwidth. And that minus 3 dB bandwidth, once it is known, then the rise time is given by, that is rise time is equal to 0.35 divided by bandwidth, as bandwidth is a frequency range and that is in denominator. If we take, that is nothing but 0.35 into 1 upon bandwidth. So bandwidth inverse is a time period. So rise time depends upon your bandwidth, and that from that you also can calculate the bandwidth, and bandwidth is equal to 0.35 divided by the rise time of the signal. So here rise time is a shorted rise time. Rise time in the sense as the time is required for the signal to rise from 0 to 1 or to rise from the 1 to 0. So that is called as a rise time. And from that rise time, you can calculate the bandwidth supported by the channel. Suppose you have a wire, then you can calculate how much time the signal takes to rise from 0 to 1 or from 1 to 0. Once that is available, that is TR, you can easily calculate the bandwidth of that wire by putting that value here in this formula, that is 0.35 divided by the rise time. You will get the bandwidth. So Hartree is a scientist. He has stated the relation that the channel capacity or the data rate is twice the channel bandwidth. Whatever be the channel bandwidth you calculated from earlier formula, the capacity of that wire will be to support the data rate double of the its bandwidth capacity. So it is given by the channel capacity or data rate is equal to 2 times of the bandwidth supported by the channel. But it has been seen that as those wires are going to have some noise because of environmental connectors. Environmental connectors, in the sense, I want to say that when you see a circuit and have the serial communication, means only two wires for the serial communication, but actually the other circuitry is also present, and that other circuitry is also having their own serial communication or parallel communication channels. So they have the inductive and capacitive effect developed over there, and which is going to cause the noise level in your channel. Considering that noise level in the channel, Shannon and Hartley modified the relation given by the Hartley, that which was C is equal to 2B, that is data rate is equal to twice of the bandwidth, and they redefined that the channel capacity not only depends upon the bandwidth, but it also depends upon the signal to noise ratio in the channel. And the formula is C is equal to B times log to the base 2 in bracket 1 plus S by N, where C is the data rate in bit per second, B is the channel bandwidth in hertz, which was calculated by earlier formula, that is bandwidth is equal to 0.35 divided by the rise time TR, and S is the signal power. Whatever the signal you want to transfer, calculate the power of that signal, that will be placed here in the numerator, and the noise in the channel you just calculated in watts, and that will be placed here in denominator. So that is going to give you the actual data rate which is supported by the channel, considering its bandwidth as well as the signal to noise ratio capacity. The signal to noise ratio should be higher, means when this term will be higher, either the numerator should be higher or the denominator should be smaller. When the denominator is smaller, it means that the noise is very, very small. When the noise is small, definitely the signal to noise ratio will be higher, and you will get a more channel data rate possible over there. As we have seen the relation between bit rate and the bandwidth, now we are going to see the relation between bit rate and the baud rate. The bit rate, we already know, bit rate is the number of bits transferred per second from transmitter to receiver or receiver to transmitter, and it is denoted by the unit, that is bits per second. Baud rate in same fashion is defined as the number of data transitions per second. What do you mean by data transitions per second is that, suppose you want to transfer a zero, then there will be a transition from 1 to 0. If you transfer 1, then there will be a transition from 0 to 1. So that transition, how many such transitions are there, that transitions are going to represent the baud rate mainly. So when the data transition period is equal to the one data bit, that time the bit rate and baud rate both will be same. But in real time, that doesn't actually happen. More often, the baud rate is the number of characters transmitted per second. So here, how many characters you are transmitting in 1 second, that will decide the baud rate, and which will be equal to the bit rate divided by the number of characters given or the number of bits given in the one frame or one word. So if you want to write a formula, you can write it in this fashion, that baud rate is equal to the bit rate divided by the number of characters in a frame transmitted per second. By this relation, if you know the baud rate, you can also calculate the bit rate, and that bit rate will be equal to, that is baud rate times number of characters in a frame transmitted per second. In asynchronous serial communication, it do not use any clock, and it use one special format, and that format is known as a 8-N-1 format. In 8-N-1 format, whatever the data you are having, now from here, bit 0 to bit 7, you are having total 8 bits. with that 8 bits you are supposed to use additionally 2 bit, as this is given as a start bit. Start bit is shown by the logic 0, and there will be a stop bit which is shown by the logic 1. So whenever you want to transfer any 8 bit of information, instead of 8 bit now you are going to transfer 2 extra bits with that. So a frame is consisting of in total 10 bits, and one is a start bit and second is a stop bit, and this kind of format is called as a 8-n-1 format. You can see here, whenever the transmitter uses to transfer a data, at the start of each frame it will always have the transition from 1 to 0. So on receiver side, whenever receiver senses a transition from 1 to 0, it recognizes that this is a start bit. Now next bit will be the first bit. In order to get the first bit, it waits till the center of your bit, that is time duration half of the bit 0 time duration. So it is actually going to wait for the 1.5 times the time period of 1 bit. So here it is going to sense the next bit, and if it is high, it is going to recognize it as a logic 1. Again from here it is going to sense the center of the next bit, then center of next bit. In same fashion it is going to detect all the bits at the receiver, and when finally there will be a transition from 0 to 1, finally it will sense a logic high signal for a duration say 1 bit or 1.5 bit or 2 bit. It means that data transmission has been finished, and whatever was the high status at the last, that was a stop bit. So you must have the knowledge of data transmission, whether it is going to happen in a 10 bit format or 11 bit format, or if any other format, that is very important in order to select the proper protocol. As we are going to see three kinds of protocol. One is a RS-232 protocol, second is a SIP protocol, and third is a I2C protocol. While selecting a particular protocol, you must be very sure that what kind of serial communication you are looking for. As we have seen in a figure, that figure is showing 8-n-1 format, where it is going to have 2 bits extra as a start bit, which is logic 0, and the stop bit as a logic 1. Remember, for every 8 bit data, the start bit will always be logic 0 and the stop bit will always be logic 1. If you have the bit rate of say 9600 bits per second, you can calculate what will be the bit duration by 1 upon the bit rate, and we have already seen this example earlier. It comes out to be around 104 milliseconds. To indicate the beginning of the transition, the transmitter sends a logic 0 for 1 bit width. After the start bit, the transmitter now sends the 8 bits in sequence, beginning with the LSB if it is a little Indian architecture. If it is in case big Indian architecture, definitely it is going to send the most significant bit first, and at last it will send the least significant bit. As the transmitter has sent logic 1, which indicates that stop bit at the end of your 7th bit which you already transmitted, immediately after the stop bit or at any other time, the transmitter may again send a fresh start bit as a logic 0. So that will show that now it is going to have the beginning of new data to be transmitted or the new frame to be transmitted. At the receiving side, the transition from logic 1 to logic 0, the receiver is going to know that now as it has gone from 1 to 0, it indicates as a start bit of new frame, and it come to know that new word is about to arrive. Further, receiver reads the logic state of each bit, okay, and remember, as I said, that it is going to sense each bit at the middle of its bit time period. This is used to avoid the phase difference between the transmitter and the receiver. Remember, as we are not using a clock here, so here problem is that the receiver and transmitter, they must have maximum 3% of phase difference in between. So with that 3% of phase difference, it has been seen that it is better to sense each bit at the middle of the each bit time period. Now reading in the middle of the bit period, it helps the and ensures the receiver that it is going to detect all the values correctly, even if the transmitter and receiver clocks are not perfectly matched in the phase or the frequency. As we said that the receiver is going to sense in the middle of the bit, to sense that bit, how that is achieved. Though we say that it is asynchronous data to be transmitted, but actually it is not asynchronous. It uses some clock so that it gets the trace of the middle of that bit. How it does is that Let me show in this example. Suppose this is the bit you want to transfer. This is a start bit of your asynchronous data. This is your bit 0 and this is bit 1. The rest of the frame is not shown here. So this bit 0, what it is that in order to sense next bit, that is bit 0 here, sorry. This is a start bit. In order to sense the bit 0, it has to wait to the center of this bit. So in order to get into center of this bit, what it does is that the both the transmitter and receiver now going to use a clock. And that clock is given by the value equal to bit rate times the 16. What is bit rate here is that whatever the duration of one bit you want to transfer, suppose that duration here is having 104 microsecond, that is TB is equal to 104 microsecond. From that you calculate the bit rate, that is R is equal to 1 upon TB, and you get a bit rate of 9600 bits per second for this data to be transmitted. Now what the clock used by the transmitter and receiver is equal to this bit rate, that is 9600 multiplied by 16. If you put it into the calculator, you get a value of 153,600 bits per second. So the transmitter and receiver is now going to use a clock with a bit rate of 16 times the bit rate of your actual data to be transmitted. Why it does so is that in order to sense the start bit, what it will do, it will wait for the 16 clock cycles. Then in order to sense the center of the bit 0, it has to wait for next 8 clock cycles. So from beginning of communication, in total, it waits for the 24 clock cycles. After these 24 clock cycles of receiver clock, it comes to know that now it is the middle of the data transmitted bit 0. So it senses at the 24th clock what is the sense, what is the status of this line. Here in this example, it is sensed as a logic 1. Again from here, it now waits for the 16 clock cycles and then again sends the logic of this line. Now it senses as a 0. In same fashion, from the beginning after 24 clock cycles, for all next bit to be read, it is going to wait for the 16 clock cycles each. And like this, it guarantees that it is going to sense the center of the bit transmitted, which is the advantage of the asynchronous serial communication. This is how, without actually on the basis of clock, without syncing with the clock, it is going to sense the data, whether it is a logic 1 or logic 0. Moving further, let's see the synchronous serial communication. So here you can see the clock is completing one clock cycle within one bit of your data. That is, clock is twice the frequency of your data to be transmitted. So here on the basis of syncing with this clock, it is going to sense what data is being transmitted. Here it is not going to use any start bit or stop bit. Simply the data will be transmitted in sync with the clock, and on the basis of each clock, whenever there will be a falling edge, it is going to sense the data. As there is a falling edge, on falling edge the data is also having the change in a state, like from 1 to 0. So that is nothing but the bit 7 is nothing but the logic 0. Then on next clock from the falling edge 1 to 0, it senses that the data is going from 0 to 1, that is sensed as a logic 1. Again on next falling edge, it senses the logic as a logic 1. In same fashion, on each falling edge, it is going to sense what is the status of the data, and in that fashion the data will be received at the receiver. So we have seen so far asynchronous and synchronous serial communication. So here we are going to see what are the different synchronous and asynchronous serial communication protocols. So you can see asynchronous serial communication protocol are of these three types, that is RS-232, RS-422 and RS-485. So out of these three, we will see in detail the RS-232 protocol. And in synchronous category, there are two protocols, that is called as a I2C protocol and SIP protocol. We will see RS-232, I2C and SIP in detail. Further, Little Endian and Big Endian architecture. In Little Endian architecture, the data is represented in this fashion. On the right hand side, you are having the LSB, whereas on left hand side, you are having the most significant bit. You can see this is the most standard we found in the Intel microprocessors. Whereas on the other side, there is a Big Endian architecture. The Big Endian architecture is shown in this fashion, where on the right hand side, it has most significant bit, and on the right hand side, it has least significant bit. This kind of architecture is generally found in the AMD processor and in some of the Xilinx processor. What are different modes of communication? This is very important. When you get a serial communication, the serial communication is of three types. It is having three types of mode of communication. The first is called as a simplex. What happens in simplex is that there are two terminals, or you can say transmitter and receiver, but at a time the data will be flowing only in one direction. Means, as shown in this figure, only A can transfer data to B, but B cannot transfer data to A. Here B will always act as a receiver and the A will always act as a transmitter. So in simplex mode of communication, there is only one direction of the transmission. In half duplex kind of communication, what you can see is that terminal A can transfer data to terminal B. Also, terminal B can transfer data to terminal A, but not simultaneously. When one direction communication is going, the other direction communication will be off. Means when A is going to transfer data to B, that time B cannot transfer data to A. On the other hand, when B is being transferred to data A, that time A cannot transfer data to B. So here you can have the other direction communication, but not simultaneously. Whereas in full duplex communication, you can see here that both terminal A and terminal B can transfer data simultaneously in both direction. So that is what we have seen in detail, the basics of serial communication. See you in next lecture, where we are going to see RS-232 protocol in detail. So thank you so much for attending this lecture. Have a nice day.